let's see. No, I want to share this. Yeah. So anyway, yeah, just even just you know, a number of 4 years. This is incredible to me how fast this is evolving. 1970. Of course, you get Chicago. There's this that 25 or 64 tune. Even still, it's entirely different than the previous year, you know. Especially for Jerry, for you guys that trombone players, man. You gotta listen to some Chicago, man. That dude's my hero. Let me see if I can do this. Oh, that's not what I... Oh! Well, that's not really what I wanted, but... where'd it go? Here's what I want. So, yeah, so 1970, we got that. You also have I'll Be There, ABC by the Jackson 5s, number 7, number 15 on the Billboard Top 100 for that year. I don't remember seeing where 25 or 6 to 4 came in. It may have been not on there, but it's certainly, of course, one of the more popular ones. 1971, you get The Temptations still hanging in there. Just My Imagination Running Away With Me, another iconic tune from them. Then 1973... something altogether different.
Nice.
What I'd love to do sometime is have a somebody who's qualified to do this do a class on the specific, like, the voicings of this band. I think that's one of the things that really sets a lot of these bands apart from one another is how things are written. Sometimes you have two or three, four. In this case, I see two trumpets, three saxes for this horn section. It's a very unique sound. You're missing the trombone, Jerry. Sorry.
Yeah. Monday.
But yeah, so the instrumentation, of course, has a great deal of effect. I think that, you know, there could be an awesome class done on writing for horn sections, for sure.
Absolutely.
I'm certainly not the person that could do that class, but but no, this so the soli in this thing, just, oh, this is one of my favorite bits. I got to play this for you. I don't know what those voices are, but they're ridiculous. Anyway, so that's kind of where the Tower of Power stuff sort of, at least for, you know, for the sake of this little class, I guess. You guys know Shining Star, Earth, Wind, and Fire kind of sort of takes over into pop music as, you know, the top, well, I don't know, my opinion, top horn band for the 70s anyway. Shining Star is a super, you know, super famous one. September, of course, or In the Stone. I do like that one.
Yep.
Sorry. But yeah, obviously we're getting close to the 80s here, man. You're getting a lot more of that, the synthesized sound of the 80s. Still with, like, lots of horns happening, and, you know, obviously very happy about that. The last secular tune that I have, we jump ahead quite a bit to 1995 with Tower Power again one more time on Sold Out. We'll just do about a minute of this one.
Nice.
Oh, Barry Sack.
Yeah.
Sorry, I could listen to that all night long, man. But what I think we see here, I'm looking at what I have in my playlist. I'm going to kind of jump ahead a little bit. So this is 1995. This is skipping ahead. Ooh, wait a minute. Yeah, this is skipping ahead to 2002 with Kirk Franklin. So it kind of jumped over a bit of some of the earlier, again, you know, I don't know, just gospel, contemporary Christian artists. But this, for me, the sounds that you're hearing here in the horn section, the mixing of it all, the songs, the singing style of the vocalist, there's a, I think it's obvious that there's a huge influence. You also got, with this particular song anyway, you've got definitely that Latino influence, this salsa Latino style that's influencing this. I'll play one more little clip out of the middle of this tune. Anyway, oh man, I'm digging this too, man.
Yep.
This is, I'm so excited about this class, man. This, I've been getting to listen to all these horn things the last few days. It's been awesome. I've just been eating it up.
Some good parts.
Uh-oh. Oh, it's because of my, hang on just a second here. Whoa, that's not what I wanted. All right, where am I going? What am I doing here? Here we go. Oh, come on now, baby. How do I get it? Oh, here we go. Yeah. All right. Hang on. I got sunshine. Oh, man. Those tunes never get old. I grew up on that stuff.
Nice.
All right. So, so the next thing, 2005. I'm really glad that it's you two guys here because you know me well enough. To know that I selected several of these last ones here because not because I know so much about gospel music, because I really don't, honestly, but I happen to play on these tracks, and so I did know these albums already.
Nice.
But they also go right along with this I think this thing. So we're gonna listen a little bit of this guy here.
Wait.
yes it does. It also with the games. It brings healing to every kind. You know the righteous, righteous running. And I say,
yes, Lord. Ooh, I can't get. This stuff, I don't know. I don't know how anybody can listen to this stuff and sit still, man. What's also amazing to me, really, I mean, with especially with the last couple things and some of the other, especially Kirk Franklin things that I listened to, the horns absolutely have become so involved and so incorporated, you know, like we talked about earlier with those bands like Chicago, Earth, Wind, and Fire, that sound of those horn sections. And they've become really just incorporated into the sounds of these groups. They're not dominant by any means, but they are like that extra little element in there. And again, you guys already being, you know, horn guys that play in horn sections, it's that little cherry on the top. I mean, you've got, you know, the rest of the praise band, of course, you can, they totally can work very well by themselves, but I think the horns just add that extra little bit of flavor, and in some cases a little bit of extra punch to certain things. This is a really cool one. I don't know this artist really very much at all, but there's a really cool little horn bit in here. So obviously we're well out of the soul R&B range into whatever that is. I don't know. To me, it's just pop music, you know. There's one other funny one I'll play here in just a little bit, but for me, thinking about playing in horn sections, again, you got all these little exposed bits, these introductions that, you know, introduce pieces or maybe some kind of little horn breakout thing. From a performer's standpoint, not from a religious standpoint, but just a performer, you know, I've got to make sure that I've got basically as much control over my instrument as possible so that I can try to execute a lot of this stuff. From the religious side of things, you guys know every single bit as much of this as I do or anyone else. For me personally, it's a funny balancing act. I know for a fact that really, regardless of how I approach a performance or a service or whatever, you know, the Lord can use whatever he needs to or wants to or any of that, you know.
Amen.
For sure. But I also would like to try to always give him my very best effort, you know.
Absolutely.
Whatever the best is that I have, you know. And I think that, you know, I think all of this, it starts, you know, sitting like right in here when I'm practicing, or if we're sitting at home practicing, or if we're sitting at the core on a Wednesday night or Sunday morning, we're just always trying to, I always just felt like I should always be trying to better myself. So that way when I do bring something, you know, to him, it's always the very best that it always will be the very best. But in the event that I'm not able to really do very well, it's always going to be my best effort, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I know that he can use anything to speak to someone, but I don't want to rely on him having to intervene. You guys know, I think you know what I'm saying anyway. I do feel really strongly about that. You know, I thought, I grew up in church and sang in choir growing up in church, and And I even remember at the time, you know, being kind of puzzled by, and it's not a judging thing, but, you know, people just kind of show up and just hang out and they're just there to have fun, I guess, maybe, or maybe it is the fellowship. I don't know, but maybe all the performing that I do in the secular world, maybe, you know, makes me a little bit too stuffy or serious. I don't know. I don't think I'm a serious human being. But I think though that, you know, I do think that, you know, when it comes to what we're bringing in to worship, we should take it seriously. I feel bad saying that. You guys already know all this stuff. It was in my notes.
No, that's good.
So just kind of just a bit of, not necessarily review, but one of the things that I've noticed in all of these, especially as this whole thing progresses, this horn sections being included in music, able to just add that extra little bit of spice or punch, you know, the Kirk Franklin example that I played, let's see, you had, man, if I can remember right, that was the one, there was the.
Yeah, he rang.
Where'd it go? Yeah, it had the Latin flavor. Where was it? Yeah, so those horn lines come straight out of some salsa playing at a Riverwalk thing down in San Antonio or what, whatever, Tampa. I don't know, wherever you guys have
yeah.
in Florida, man. But you've got the vocals. That choir, the choir sounds that are in there, very much of that gospel choir. And then, hold on. Whatever that is, I don't know what that is. whatever that would be called, I don't know. But you've got all these layers in there, you know? And I think it's been real interesting going back through a lot of old Kirk Franklin stuff. Because there's several different kind of almost eras. They don't last very long necessarily, but it's been very interesting. I'm glad that I got to do this. I guarantee that I learned way more than you guys will learn from me, but it's been really cool. I think there's a lot of potential in this. I think there's a lot of potential in this class that I'm leading, if I maybe get it right. But in all seriousness, the things I think of, it's certainly not that when it's sitting in a brass band or an orchestra or a brass quintet or whatever, any other setting, it's not that I don't have attention to detail. I don't think that when we're sitting in a large brass band, we can be, nonchalant about details, about intonation, about articulation, about rhythmic accuracy, but those larger groups, they have a way of kind of rounding out the edges a bit. With these horn sections, it's so transparent. So it's crucial that we have this you know, maybe you could even say a higher level of accuracy, rhythmic and pitch-wise. But we also, more than anything, it's just that there's more potential there for that. I'll get out of this screen share business. There's more potential for that because there's so much more room for us to have that, you know, that kind of level of punch to things. All of it again is just, it's going to come from the practice that we do in the background. You guys of course know all about that. The biggest difference probably between, you know, again, I hate labels, but what you would call classical style, and for the most part I would lump brass band into that. You have a lot of classical style elements for sure, and then the horn section stuff lumped more in with commercial things, but it's just what I tell my students. 96, I use this phrase, I don't know if this is exactly right, 96% of all styles, all genres, across the ages for trumpet players, 96% of it is the same. It's quality sound, you know, being able to get up and down the horn, be in control of what kind of articulation I use, in control of my vibrato, you know, the colors in my sound, being able to manipulate those things consciously, like so that I'm in charge of those things. Then when I sit down, if I'm sitting in a Baroque ensemble or if I'm sitting in a jazz band or a brass quintet, I just tweak those last 4%. You know, it's slight changes in articulation, maybe a slight difference in vibrato, those types of things. Where this is maybe, I certainly don't know every trumpet player that plays commercial music in the world. But one of the things that I know that I am slightly different than a lot of people who do this on a regular basis. A lot of the things I've studied, so as a lead trumpet player in a big band, I never really studied playing lead trumpet. I didn't ever set out to try to play high notes. I transcribed Clifford Brown, Miles Davis, Clark Terry, these dudes that are not, you know, high note trumpet players at all. And then again, too, all the influences from the Motown stuff, the Earth, Wind, and Fire, Chicago, all those things. It all goes into this big soup pot that is the way that I play. Daryl, you've got that, of course. Jerry, you've got that. Everyone has that one way or another. So what we put in there definitely influences those sounds. But with regard to this particular thing, these kind of horn section type things, I model my sound, my articulation, my phrasing, all of those things I model after these singers that are in these bands. So like Chicago and Tower Power, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Aretha Franklin, like all these vocalists. And I try to mimic that as much as possible. And the other aspect of it, so that's more to do with the tonal aspect of it, the rhythmic part of it. One of the things that the horn section can add so much is in these hits, these pops, shots, whatever you want to call them. They can be so percussive. And so again, that all goes into articulation, being able to have a variety of articulation, wide palette to choose from, of course. Let's see. Oh yeah, lastly, this is maybe the trickiest part, I think, about playing in a horn section. And I'm sure you guys have experienced this for sure. You get these recordings, everybody listens to these recordings, so you go play with some group or whatever, they've been listening to the recording. It's recordings of horns with the bands, but the horns are off in a studio in their own room, you know, burning. And then they go, and so it's like this big, but it's the sound of these burning horns that is this big. And but then they want it to sound like that, but you can't play like that. So there's really no solution to that situation. You can't, I mean, you guys already know you can't get that sound playing piano. So what ends up happening actually is when you're playing with praise bands or horn band type situations, they're loud enough, it's fine. But that's the biggest challenge, and I've still yet to find any way to sort that out, honestly. So maybe if I do, I can write a book and I'll make like $20 or $30 maybe off of it. Sell it to dozens of people. Oh, man. So anyway, yeah, I was telling them, Andy, I set this all up for, you know, thinking I would have a bunch of like high school kids or something in here. And so I just kind of went through this thing, a little bit of an abridged version, really. But we do have a couple minutes. Not that I think you guys are just on the edge of your seat waiting to ask me any questions, but if you have any questions, we got a few minutes, 5 minutes or so, or anything you all want to discuss.
No, I mean, I would ask you, who's your favorite horn arranger? Like, I mean, obviously you got the greats between, if you're talking about big band stuff with like Quincy Jones and the Sinatra stuff, or like, and for me, obviously the modern day king is Jerry Hay.
Oh my
who
gosh.
Did
yeah.
all of the Earth, Wind, and Fire stuff and some Chicago stuff. Now he's doing that. What's that group? It's a group now that's insane. But like, he always writes all the stuff that Gary Grant, Wayne Bergeron, those guys are playing. He's the, you know, he did all Michael Jackson stuff. He did all of their stuff. Like, so who would you...
Killer.
Like, is there somebody that you listen to where it's like, okay, I see that guy's arranged it. I have to listen to that song just because.
Well, I mean, yeah, yes. And again, I mean, I don't think... And I think you know, I think you know this dude, or you know his name, but Philip Lassiter.
Yeah, I know Phil. Yeah.
Yeah, he's done stuff for Transmission.
Yep.
I found that out at commissioning, I guess it was two summers ago now.
Yeah.
But yeah, he was doing his master's degree when I was doing my bachelor's degree here.
Cool.
And so I got to know him a little bit. I'll have to send you a copy. We had a band here. It's called, it was a Sound Doctrine. That's what it was. And it was a lot of his earliest writings. And
That's real cool.
Interesting because it's just obvious influences from like Kirk Franklin, you know, the early 90s, mid 90s Kirk Franklin stuff. We were in school together like 96 to 98, I think was when he was here.
That's awesome.
Maybe.
That's crazy.
Dude,
we were he's puppies, the guy, man. Right now. Like, I mean, he's the guy. Yeah. Like any Christian thing that you're hearing on the radio,
man,
it's him. He's the guy who's arranging it.
He's doing everything, man.
Yeah.
Everybody did that deal with Prince. He was the horn section arranger and leader for Prince those last maybe about the last year that Prince was alive.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. I do remember, it was funny. I've not talked to him, and I wouldn't ask him because it's too personal. But and I have no idea how much money he made doing that.
Yeah.
But I know he took that gig, and then 3 months after he took that gig, he's like, all right, all my student loans are paid off. I was like, what? No, I don't know. Maybe he didn't have much left, but I'm betting that gig probably paid pretty.
Yeah, it had to. I mean,
it probably paid pretty good. He, we had him do a masterclass last year for the jazz division here last spring when everybody's out of whack, you know. And he talked he talked a little bit about that situation. He had gotten the call to play in that horn section. They went to this big, like, I think it was like 10 or 11, 12 member horn section.
Mm-hmm.
And he talked about when he basically got the gig, he was playing in that horn section and they were in a rehearsal and they were trying to figure out some voicing for some deal or whatever. And that dude's ears are like
huge. Yeah, they have to be correct.
He's really got good piano skills as well. He's kind of self-taught piano. But he was able to, they were listening to something. They heard whatever the chord was. They were trying to figure it out. And he was able to go over and be like, no, it's this right here. And he's like, bing, bing, bing. And it was right on the money. He voiced it out. Whatever he does, I don't know, man.
Yeah.
He voiced it out for all those horns, those 10 horn players or whatever, and played it. And Prince loved it. And then later that day, he got a phone call. It was later that night or the next morning or something. They were like, yeah, Prince wants to talk to you. He's like, okay, of course. Like, what else do you mean? Of course, that's what you say. Like, when? Tell me when. I'll be there, man. And they were like, this time, you know, be there, you know, be ready to go, whatever. He showed up, said just a few words. And he's like, I like that. Yeah, I like that. I want you to do this. And then he just left. and Phil was like, I think I just got this job. Like, this porn section, man.
That's crazy.
But a lot of Philip Lassiter's, at least the earlier influences, what's that? Roy Hargrove, that trumpet player. But Roy Hargrove, of course, is also a Dallas musician. Kirk Franklin, of course, grew up in Dallas. Those guys all had a mutual friend and colleague, whatever, in Bobby Sparks, who owns a studio out in maybe Mesquite, Texas, I think is where it is, out on the east side of Dallas.
Cool.
And there was that connection there. There's also another tenor saxophonist. He may have been on that Kirk Franklin project. I was on that album, that He Reigns tune also. I got to play. That was one of the first big things I got to do down there with Philip. But as a tenor sax player named Keith Anderson, who went to high school with Roy Hargrove. So there's just this connection down there of all these Dallas folks, man. And I mean, it's almost like a lot of even early 90s, mid 90s gospel thing was kind of blowing up out of Dallas, Texas, of all things. And Philip had moved down there. He had finished his master's here. He'd moved down there to be the music person at I can't remember the name of the church. It's a big old Pentecostal church. I think Phil's dad is a Pentecostal pastor. At the time was here in Oklahoma City, but again, that's 25 years ago. Who knows? He's probably done by now, probably. But But yeah, so a lot of those earlier influences I know were from like Roy Hargrove stuff. You've heard those trumpet stacking things that Phil.
Yeah.
That stuff is so nasty, man.
Yeah, like the funniest thing about it, it makes sense just you saying that, because that's like the stuff that Roy was doing as well. Like, especially because Roy really did it was a thing called Neo Soul, and Roy was the horn arranger for all of these Neo Soul albums. Like Common, Erykah Badu, who's from Dallas as well. All of those Neo Music Soul Child, all these Neo Soul artists, Roy Hargrove did all of the horn charts for them. And it was that husky,
man,
stacked flugelhorn but trumpet sound that just is really, you know, that now is like a calling card for Phil Lasseter. It's funny.
Yeah, there's a... Oh, I can't remember which one of those albums. I didn't get to play on all the tunes on all those albums. It may have been that Natalie, was her Natalie Grant? Is that her name? What's her name?
Yeah.
It may have been on that album. It's funny to me because I see that album and, you know, you see her standing there and like you expect to hear a certain thing and then you hit play and you're like, that's not the music I expect to be coming out of her. But there's, cool. I don't remember who it was. Yeah, it's really hip. It's just different. But you know, I've just been fascinated going over all this stuff the last several days, and just seeing how absolutely intertwined all of the progression of all of this stuff is between the secular and the religious artists. I don't know that either one would have ever existed without the other, you know, or at least certainly not the way that it is now.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Not to change the subject earlier, but you asked about horn arrangers. I was shocked to find out that Little Steven of the E Street Band and also of The Sopranos and of Lilyhammer, the TV show, he organized and did all of the arrangements for the horn section of the E Street Band. So all of that stuff that, what's his name, the saxophonist.
What?
That's crazy.
Yeah. He so the guitar, the lead guitarist still to this day writes all those horn charts and that horn section. Now they use them. It's a horn section now plays for a lot of other bands on recordings and things, but he does all of the arranging for that. I don't know that I would, obviously it's not a style that I dig as far as the horn playing is concerned. It's a little old school rock and roll, but it's still, I was amazed. You're just talking about just people who are just musicians that do things that you would be shocked by, but that Little Steven of all
people. That's crazy. Anyway. I had no idea.
Yeah.
Didn't know. It's wild. I'm continually amazed at just how small of the world is, you know. It's incredible. But, well, I don't know, man. That's